Years have brought growing attention to the lack of diversity among film actors and the creators of American movies. And a new report this week shows just how wide the gap remains, despite some high-profile successes. Jeffrey Brown has the story.
Special effects.
We're gonna have to jump.
I can't.
Action and suspense. Big production films in recent years have provided plenty of what audiences have come to expect, including, according to various studies, a widespread lack of diversity. The latest research comes from the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism at the University of Southern California. The survey of the annual 100 top grossing films between 2007 and 2014 found that just 30% of all speaking or named characters were women, while 73% of such roles went to whites. As to the filmmakers, only about 2% of the movies were directed by women. The website Every Single Word has made a mission of highlighting the lack of diversity in movies by compiling every line spoken by a person of color in any major film. This video from the 2014 movie Maleficent lasted just 18 seconds. The creator of Every Single Word, Dylan Marron, joins us now. He's also an actor and writer. Also with us, Washington Post movie critic Anne Hornaday. Well, Dylan Marron, you have been documenting this for a long time. How does this new study sharpen the picture? What jumps out at you?
I mean, I think a lot jumps out. One of the biggest things that jumped out for me is the correlation between black directors and putting black characters in their movie. And that speaks a lot to this conversation we have, you know, of we need more creators. The creators are already out there. But what we need to do is we need to take those creators and we need to project their stories onto a bigger screen, and they need to be distributed to a larger audience. And that way there will be more accurate reflections of the populations they're serving.
You're an actor yourself, so you've seen this play out?
I've seen this firsthand. Yeah, I've seen it in meetings with agents, I've seen it in casting calls, and I've just seen it in general reception.
So, Anne Hornaday, you know, we've talked about this before. For both women and African Americans, actors and directors, there have been some very successful and critically acclaimed films, especially in recent years. Do we see these as exceptions? What do you see when you look out there?
Well, absolutely. I mean, you know, the last couple of years have really seen a flowering, and we've seen this wonderful renaissance in African American filmmaking from the likes of Dee Reese and Ava DuVernay and Ryan Coogler. And Gina Prince Bythewood, of course, who's been around for a while, but has just been doing wonderful work. So there's been a lot to celebrate. And then this year, you know, a number of the top 10 movies this year are female-centric, from things like 50 Shades of Grey and Cinderella to Spy and Trainwreck, also did very well this summer. So, and there are smaller movies that are featuring women, like Ricky and the Flash is coming out this weekend, and The Diary of a Teenage Girl. So things like this, studies like this, you know, we get these statistics as sort of a steady drumbeat, and it's just a reminder that we should, you know, remember not to fall over ourselves with gratitude for crumbs when the bigger picture, as you point out, is a lot more sobering.
Well, and one of the possible responses would be, this is what audiences want, this is what sells, this, it's a business, right? Is that true?
Well,
is that, does that help explain what we're seeing or not?
No, it's, yes, you're right, it's a business. And what, you know, I think this kind of lack of representation actually has three costs. And the first is absolutely financial. I mean, Hollywood is leaving money on the table when women and African American audiences prove over and over again that they go see movies about themselves. And so for studios to not cater to those audiences, women alone, women of all races, buy 50% of the movie tickets, and they heavily influence, you know, the other 50%. The other big cost would be aesthetic, in terms of just the actual stories that are being told, and the grand diversity and sort of texture and depth of the stories that we're missing up on screen. And then the most, maybe the most profound cost is really psychic, in terms of when, especially when young people are going to the movies and they see this sort of monolithic, monotone, monochromatic version of what it is to be human. That's what we're internalizing as the norm.
So Dylan Marron, what do you see as the causes? Why does it continue?
Well, I mean, I think this is largely structural, right? So people are just so concerned about losing money. And you mentioned leaving money on the table. I think these financiers, everyone who's putting up money for these films, they're really operating on archaic and even imaginary statistics. They are so afraid that if they change up the formula, if they don't keep putting white people in the leads of these movies as these protagonist roles, that they're going to lose money. But as we see with the Fast and the Furious and other big franchises that kind of branch out, this is just not true.
And yet, Dylan, there is a growing awareness, right? Your site is popular on, it made a lot of inway on social media. We see a lot of studies like this. So there is certainly more awareness, at least.
I think there's a lot of awareness, but what does that do? You know, we just saw the trailer for the Stonewall movie come out. That's the new Roland Emmerich film about the Stonewall riots. And it's completely whitewashed, right? There's a black trans woman who actually was one of the leaders, and she's completely silenced. It's rewritten to include a white cis male lead. So the whitewashing continues. People have been aware for so long. I am continuing the tradition of awareness. I just presented it in a new way.
So Anne Hornaday, just you started to mention some films that are. I just want to give you a brief chance here, if there are for people that want to see films that portray this piece of American life that often isn't portrayed. Where do they look?
Well, you know, I think to Dylan's point, a big problem is the financing structure, and more the financing is either coming from international financiers or it's being oriented toward international audiences. And there's this assumption that only, you know, certain stories and characters will sell overseas. We are seeing some really encouraging work on the indie scale. I mean, I mentioned Diary of a Teenage Girl, which is a wonderful depiction of a young woman coming of age. I would include a really interesting movie called Tangerine about two trans women in L.A. It's kind of this raucous, you know, picaresque day in the life, very funny, very closely and intimately and compassionately observed. And then sort of mid-range movies like Ricky and the Flash with Meryl Streep. I mean, you know, they're still getting made, and generally when they do get made, they do really well if they can hang on long enough and find an audience.
All right. Anne Hornaday, Dylan Marron. But thank you both very much.